WebRTC is the undisputed king of media streaming. All major conferencing software uses it behind the scenes, from Discord to Google Meets, Jitsi, and WhatsApp.
Super Twinkle! Very cool!
But honestly, it is still a pain to scale and almost impossible to customize. There are many protocols that have to get together for WebRTC to work. And by the way, you are still on the hook for defining the signaling between the peers. The WebRTC documentation does contain an example, but it's just a proof of concept. You really have to come up with a solid signaling protocol. Signaling in WebRTC is coordinating the communication and establishing the media sessions between the peers in a call. Also, there's outdated information out there claiming that WebRTC uses peer-to-peer. The reality is that nowadays, nobody uses it like that, because it's very hard for peers to find each other around the world, especially with all these routers and firewalls in between. Because of the complexities of running WebRTC at scale,
such an instrument is the turbo encapsulator,
and the shortcomings of WebSockets, which we covered in this channel extensively, a new protocol was created on top of HTTP3, WebTransport. Think of WebTransport like WebSockets, but without the head-of-line blocking. So this opens the possibilities for developers. Running WebRTC is infrastructure intensive, requiring multiple server types for full functionality. In contrast to that, WebTransport significantly simplifies this architecture. To operate WebTransport, you only need an HTTP3 web server that supports WebTransport protocols like H3. WebTransport is not a competitor of WebRTC. Instead, it might be its natural successor. So I came up with this table to summarize the WebRTC technology versus WebTransport. As a developer, you interact with the supported data transfer types. In case of WebRTC, you interact with audio, video tracks, and data channels. It's important to mention that WebRTC does specify how to create an audio stream or a video stream or track, compared to WebTransport, where you get like the underlying foundation for this. You get unidirectional and bidirectional streams, but you do not get codecs. You do not get all these critical elements that tell you how the media is encoded. There's a new standard called Media Over Quick that people are working on right now. And if successful, it might provide that extra layer to make it easy to stream over WebTransport. So we went through the technology stack, but this does not answer the main question that probably you have. Which technology should you use for your next application? To answer this question, I propose that we look at both the server and the clients that are out there to see how much do we get out of the box, how much do we get out of open source. The most important library, without a doubt, is the official Google C implementation for WebRTC. Most platforms just created wrappers for these libraries. On top of the core libraries, it contains demos, such as a signaling server, so it's super useful to understand the protocol. It is pretty much the WebRTC Bible. If you're looking for a library that you can use on all mobile platforms and web, without knowing C, I recommend using this Flutter library. It's fantastic. I used it a couple of years ago and it was just rock solid. We were able to get a demo up and running in less than a day. Without a doubt, the easiest WebRTC library to use is the Web API. There are a plethora of examples out there. The Mozilla developer pages are just wonderful to understand both the protocol and the web APIs, so it's an operator. This is just really easy to use. So it seems like we have enough clients on WebRTC to just go and build something, but the issues get more interesting when you move to the server side. So it turns out that most of the challenges that I currently experience with WebRTC are on the server side. And as I was creating this video, I came across this product called LiveKit. Wow, I'm amazed by this service. It's open source, written in Go. They offer two main solutions. You can either pay for them to host LiveKit for you or to self-host it. And they use the right technology, meaning Helm charts, Kubernetes. And yeah, this looks rock solid. One thing I was wondering is, how do you scale their cluster? And just looking at it, looks like you can indeed host multiple LiveKit server pods so that you can balance and scale the traffic from all your peers. They have a built-in turn server, and the turn server is used so that peers can discover each other across the internet. This looks like a very solid piece of technology that it's worth checking out. Regardless the technology that you end up selecting for this, you will need to host it somewhere. We tried GCP, AWS, DigitalOcean, and Azure, And out of those four, DigitalOcean was the most transparent service. We are actually able to understand the bill, which is seems to be like a big thing. It seems to be like a lot to ask from the other providers. So we left a $200 referral code in the description if you are interested. On the web transport side, I'm happy to inform that one of the most mainstream messaging libraries, socket.io, already supports web transport. So looking at the release notes, their support for web transport has been added in version 4.7.0. So that's fantastic. This means that you can swap the web sockets and instead use web transport. So these are great news for web developers. Next on the list, we have Leptos Web Transport and UWeb Transport. Both crates are available completely open source at crates.io. Let me know what you think. With regards to native applications, I only found Xquake or Crossquake. I did not test it myself, but this library is backed by a major tech company. So I'm adding it for completeness. I would like to mention that this is a quick library, but once you have a quick library, it's very easy to roll out web transport on top of it. On the server side, I would like to highlight Kixelated Web Transport Queen library. We need to keep an eye on this because Kixelated is rolling out media over quick. So I'm sure that he's using this library as the foundation. The only full stack solution that I found for video streaming is videocall.rs. So as you know, that's a product that my company makes. And we just added support for Linux, which means that you can stream your camera and microphone straight from like a computer without even a browser. Okay, so let me show you this Rust video daemon. You can see that I'm passing the user ID, which video device I want to use, the meeting ID, and the URL of the server. And after pressing enter, we start streaming. And on this laptop, I am connected to that conference. And we can see the video coming through. So we feel that the roboticist will love this, but we'll see. We need to do a better job advertising ourselves. And this opens the door for new use cases in robotics and so on. If you want to learn more about videocall.rs, check out these other videos. I was hoping to mention more web transport solutions here, but I did not find complete products. I found many POCs. I expect 2024 to be the year where this technology explodes, and I'll keep you posted as new libraries are released.